time again for Talking Dogs with Ian Grant, owner of Vermont Dog Boarding and Behavior, VFW Drive High Park. It's the show that delves into the training, socializing, behavior, nutrition, and wellness of your dog. Brought to you by Guy's Farm and Yard, with locations in Morrisville, Montpelier, Williston, and St. Albans. And we're back with the trainer, Ian Grant, and this week the topic is nose, eyes, and ears. Let me take a look at Tika here. Check, check, check. Okay, all right. Anything else we're going to cover today?
Tails, fur, feet.
That's right. So what's the overall on this today?
So this comes from really what's instinctual for each dog. So let's say you're walking Tika, I'm walking Gemma, we meet each other on a path somewhere. What do you think the dogs are going to do the very first thing when they get together?
Yeah. Well, probably going to sniff each other.
There it is.
Take a look at each other and kind of feel them out, each other.
Yeah, so sniffing is the first thing.
Yeah.
So a lot of people are shocked to realize that when dogs are born, they're born deaf and blind.
Huh.
So that
I think you did mention that once before.
Yeah, so that means the only way that they can actually find their mother when they're young is either through touch or through scent. And that's what drives a dog is scent. And also the nose controls 60% of the brain. Now we realize how powerful the nose is because that's really one of the only senses they have when they're born. This is also why the dog's nose likes to be on the ground while we're trying to walk them, why they try to sniff anything and everything that you bring new into the house that they want to investigate. I mean, there's a lot of times at work, you know, a new dog comes in. If they're at least a remote bit friendly, they walk over and they want to sniff my legs, my feet. I'm covered in dog scent. I know it. So that's where that nose actually will drive them. Now, what comes after that when they're puppies is 2 weeks after they're born. This is when their eyes start to open up. So now they get to gain their eyesight and they learn in this order. So now it becomes nose, eyes, and try to get to know the world. But not too much longer after those 2 weeks is when the ears start to open up. And a puppy won't get their full amount of hearing until 5 weeks of age. So this is literally, you can think of this in order of how a dog's head is shaped, is that the nose leads the way. It's out in front. Eyes are usually second. And then the ears are further back. So that's the easy way to remember it, nose, eyes, ears. A lot of times when we have super reactive dogs, dogs that are barky, lungy, they're just eyes and ears. Their noses are completely shut down and not they're not trying to investigate. They're more concerned about maybe even survival at that point. But I think knowing this helps people understand kind of how dogs are willing to learn and understand the world.
So what's the role of the mother during all this? They kind of have to guide them through all this. I mean, if a dog is born and can't see and, you know, the mother has to be a real guide through this.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think a lot of it's instinctual, too, from puppies, knowing where they can smell where the milk is coming from and what they have to do. And that's one of the amazing parts about dogs is, you know, how much is instinctual that they're just born with. It's, you know, standard operating equipment like you get in a car. It just comes with it. But I don't think there's much of a role from dogs or from mothers until later on as far as, you know, the puppies being able to hear maybe a growl, a low growl from the mother saying, okay, look, there's your rules and the boundaries, or that eye contact when they can fully see. But knowing this also is helping the dog understand how to get to know the world. Like I said, the reactive dog. So one of my little tools that I have at work is, I say it's a tool, it's not really, it's a paper towel soaked in vinegar that I keep inside of a Ziploc bag because I want to see if the super reactive dog can even smell it. The crazy part is, as strong as a dog's nose is, when a dog can be barking so much at maybe another dog, I can put that open Ziploc bag in front of the dog's nose and they don't even smell the vinegar. Now think about how strong their nose is compared to ours and what vinegar does to us.
And they totally don't.
They don't even smell it because their nose is turned off and they're so focused with their eyes.
Their brain shuts off the nose just like that. So,
yeah.
So what? How does a reactive dog come about then? How does a dog become reactive and not depending so much on their nose?
Usually it's a series of events that's led it into figuring out that I've got to make all this sound and all this noise in order to create space and make myself feel comfortable. They've just gone over threshold. So if you remove the dog far enough away and introduce the vinegar, then they'll start to smell it and go, oh, wow, that's something brand new. But it's pretty crazy to think how their nose can almost literally be plugged during those tense situations.
I wonder if more people realize that this is the sequence and how dogs are developed, if it would affect their training of the dogs later, you know, once they've got the puppy 8, 10 weeks old.
I think that, Roland, that's a huge statement. And I wish people would understand that it's nose, eyes, ears. You know, if you have a friend come over and your dog is kind of growling at your friend, take an article of clothing from your friend and put it in front of your dog's nose, you know, when they're 20 feet away. So it creates that nose, that investigation of, like, you don't have to growl at the person walking in the door. Sniff, be curious, investigate, and you'll see that everything's, you know, that's a better way to introduce than just shove the dog into the person's space.
That's why the dogs sniff, and sniff often.
Yes.
Back with our question from the doggy bag in just a moment here on Talking Dogs. Back with Talking Dogs with Ian Grant from Vermont Dog Boarding and Behavior, VFW Drive Hyde Park. To find out more about his facility or check out the podcast that he has, including this show, on his website at VermontDogBoardingAndBehavior.com. Question this morning is, Ian, we keep our dog in our mudroom while we're gone. It's a 20-foot by 10-foot space. Should she still be in a crate in that space? Since we had a similar question on that not too awful long ago, that this is not replacing a crate, though, is it?
I wouldn't say that it's replacing a crate, but I do find that people kind of section off, like, the kitchen area because it might be a tile so that we're not, you know, staining rugs.
Having any accidents.
Yeah. Also, the mudroom area might be a tile or stone area or whatever, so that there's, you know, you're safe from that. You know, look, as long as your dog is okay with it and you're not running into any problems, I don't see a huge issue with not using a crate. And this, again, for me, as far as the crate is concerned, it just goes back to, at some point they're going to be groomed, at some point they're going to be at a vet's office, that there might be, you know, in that space, in a needing a crated space. Traveling places, you know, if you're taking your dog with you on vacation, you have to stay at a hotel, crate might be a good idea, because those are all usually floors with rugs and whatnot. So I don't want to, you know, fully take it away from a dog. I still want to be able to have them have the ability and the skill to know that this is a place that you need to go in and rest. So in this situation, I'm okay with it. I just don't ever want to completely remove it, just for the just-in-case times. That's all.
Would that take away from their crate training? If all of a sudden you don't put them in a crate, you put them in a mudroom instead, that wouldn't change anything as far as the dog's interpretation of what a crate is.
I mean, I think if you were 100% cool with it, if the dog was cool with it when you decided to do the mudroom space, I'd like to think that that association of that crate is still a positive thing. And it may not be bad to just kind of refresh it maybe a week at a time, every couple of months, just to kind of keep the dog, you know, understanding, like, this isn't going away. It's still something that we're going to use. So it's not the end of the world by any means. But again, unfortunately, there are some dogs that I know that it's, you know, that need some vet help or whatever, and they need to spend the night somewhere or whatever. And so sometimes it's just nice to know that they're going to be okay sitting in a crate.
The mudroom will never replace the crate.
No.
And shouldn't.
No.
If you have a question for Ian, you can email him directly to info@VermontDogBoardingAndBehavior.com. Next week, testing versus training.
Yeah, I have a lot of clients that want to test things out before we do any training, just to kind of see. And then I have clients that want to do training before we do the testing. And I think it's good that people understand the difference here and why we go the way we go.
All right. And we'll find out about it next week on Talking Dogs with Ian Grant. Brought to you by Guy's Farm and Yard, with locations in Mooresville, Montpelier, Williston, and St. Albans. And for the trainer Ian Grant, I'm Roland DeJoy, and we are Talking Dogs.